Good morning, everyone. In today's topic, we'd like to discuss you regarding rickettsial zoonosis or rickettsial diseases. So coming to this topic, rickettsial zoonosis, these are specific group of communicable diseases which are mainly caused by rickettsial organisms, and these are mainly transmitted to men by arthropod vectors. It is also called as Hue fever. So if you see here, they have realized that the more number of this acute febrile burden and more number of preventive illness in many populations are mainly caused due to this rickettsial diseases, and these are remaining under diagnosed. So if you see the classification here, these are mainly classified based on the clinical features and epidemiological aspects. So this is the table for the classification of this rickettsial disease. So they are mainly classified into three groups: typhus group, spotted fever group, and other types of groups. So in typhus group, if you see, the first one is epidemic typhus, and the rickettsial agent which is responsible for the disease is rickettsial provaziki, and insect vectors are louse, and mammalian reservoirs are humans. And the next type is murine typhus, and the rickettsial agent which is responsible for this disease is rickettsial typhi. And if you see the insect vector here, the insect vectors are the flea. Coming to the mammalian reservoirs, in mammalian reservoirs, rodents are the reservoirs here. And if you see here, this scrub typhus, the third type, it is mainly caused due to rickettsial tsutsugamushi. The insect vector is mite, and the mammalian reservoirs are rodents. Next group is spotted fever group. So in spotted fever group, we have Indian tick typhus, we have Rocky Mountain spotted fever, and we have rickettsial spock. So if you see the Indian tick typhus, mainly it is caused by rickettsial gonorrhoeae, and the insect vector is tick here, and the mammalian reservoirs are rodents and dogs. Next one is Rocky Mountain spotted fever, and the agent here is rickettsial rickettsii, and the insect vector is tick. And coming to the mammalian reservoirs, rodents and dogs are considered as mammalian reservoirs. And the next one is, means the last one is spotted fever group is rickettsial spock, rickettsial pox. Here if you see, the rickettsial agent is rickettsial acari, and the insect vectors are mite, and the mammalian reservoirs are mice here. And the third one means, the coming to the other types of this rickettsial diseases, the first one is Q fever, and it is mainly caused due to C. burnetii. And if you see the insect vectors, there are no insect vectors here, but the mammalian reservoirs are cattle, sheep and goats. Coming to the trench fever, the last one, Rocalmia quintana, and the insect vectors are louse, and the mammalian reservoirs are human beings. You can screenshot this picture so that it will be easy for you. Coming to the casual agents, so these rickettsial agents are, these are small bacteria, and these are obligate intracellular parasites. They are pleomorphic in nature, and they are appearing either as short rods or as cocci, and they occur singly also. They can be seen in pairs, they can be seen in short chains, or they can be seen as a filamentous type. So these are pleomorphic, means they appear in different types of shapes and different types of structures. So you can see in the statement itself here, they are appearing in the short rod type, they are appearing as a cocci, they are appearing as a single, they are also appearing as a single, and they are appearing in pairs, they are appearing in short chains, and as well as they are appearing in filamentous. Coming to the next one, if you see here, whenever this rickettsial agent is GIMSA stained, whenever it is GIMSA stained, you can see immediately under the microscope as a blue stain. So they stain blue, and they are readily visible under the microscope. The next one is, they grow readily in the yolk sac of the embryonated egg. If you see here, these are growing readily in the embryonated egg. And the next one is, this rickety shell growth is enhanced by the presence of sulfonamide. So whenever there is the disease, rickety shell disease, you should not prefer to go for the sulfonamide, because they are favoring the growth of this rickety shell organisms. Coming to the clinical features, so we can expect for Q fever, so there will be no skin lesion, and these rickety shell infections are mostly characterized by fever, headache, malaise, prostration, skin rash, enlargement of the spleen and liver. So these are the some common clinical features that you can observe in the rickety shell diseases. So you, if you see here for this rickety shell diseases, tetracycline is the drug of choice. What is the drug of choice here? The drug of choice is tetracycline, and long acting antibiotics such as doxycycline and monocycline, these have made this single dose treatment possible in the diseases rickety shell diseases. Coming to the diagnostic processes here, so these are mainly including isolation of rickettsia, and these are including some established serological tests such as indirect fluorescent antibody test and complement flexin test and the veil flex test, the veil flex test, and the newer techniques include ELISA, fluorescent antibody staining of frozen tissue sections from rickettsial lesions. So these are all the diagnostic procedures that were used in this disease, rickettsial diseases. So if you see here, among the major groups of this rickettsias, the most commonly reported diseases in India are scrub typhus, murine flea borne typhus, and Indian tick typhus and Q fever. Now we will discuss regarding the scrub typhus in detail. So if you see the distribution of this disease, scrub typhus, so it is mainly caused by the rickettsia in men, and if you see the scrub typhus, it is the most widespread disease. It is the most widespread disease in the rickettsial diseases. So if it mainly exists in the form of zoonosis in the nature between certain species of Thrombophilid and mites and their small mammals. So for example, field mice, rats and shrews. So these are the major reservoirs for this disease, scrub typhus. So scrub typhus, it is an endemic in the northern Japan and in Southeast Asia, in Western Pacific Islands, in Eastern Australia, in China and maritime areas, and several parts of South Central Russia, India and Sri Lanka. So these are the scrub typhus endemic areas. And if you see the incidence rate here, more than 1 million cases are occurring naturally. How many cases are occurring? More than 1 million cases are occurring naturally. And if you see here, most of these diseases are travel acquired. So whenever a person is visiting to the rural areas in endemic countries for activities like camping and hiking and rafting, or for field visiting, there these persons are getting affected. So you can also observe the urban cases in the scrub typhus group of diseases. Coming to the epidemiological determinants here, so coming to the agent factors, so the agent factor for this scrub typhus is scrub typhus rickettsia tsutsugamushi, and there are several serologically distinct strains that are responsible for this disease, scrub typhus. Coming to the reservoir here of infection is the thrombophilid mite, that is Leptothrombidium dillonis and lakamushi. So these organisms are the true reservoirs for this disease, scrub typhus. Coming to the mode of transmission here, so if you see this disease, scrub typhus, these are mainly occurred by the bite of infected larva and infected larval mites. So the mite, whenever it is going and infecting the rats and mice, again from these rats and mice, the mites are getting infected here. Whenever this mite is coming in contact with the humans, which is the accidental host, this disease is being transmitted to the human beings. And if you see here, this disease is directly not occurred from a person to person. This disease has to occur to the men only through infected mites. So coming to the incubation period of this disease, so the incubation period of this disease is usually 10 to 12 days, and in some times it may varies from 6 to 21 days also. So the average period is about 10 to 12 days, and it may vary between 6 days, or it may come within 21 days also. So coming to the clinical features of this scrub typhus, so they resembles epidemic typhus clinically, and if you see the onset here, at the first they will show chills and fever, and the temperature will range from 104 to 105 degree Fahrenheit, and the other associated symptoms are like headache, malaise, prostration, and a macular rash appearing on the fifth day of illness, and generalized lymphadenopathy and lymphocytosis are the most common clinical features in this disease scrub typhus. Initially you can observe fever along with the chills with the temperature of 104 to 105 degree Fahrenheit. So if you see here, one typical feature is the punched out ulcer, which is covered by the blackened scab, which is called as eschar, and it indicates the location of the mite bite. So wherever this mite is coming and biting, you can observe a punched out ulcer which is covered by the blackened scab. So it is the location where the mite has bitten. And pyrexia falls by lysis in the third week in case of untreated cases. Whenever a case is not treated, within 3 weeks you can observe the pyrexia coming down, and you can observe the Weil-Felix reaction, that is strongly positive with the proteinaceous strain OXK. So these are the some characteristics and clinical features of this disease scrub typhus. So what are all the control measures? Means first thing is treatment. So the drug of choice here is tetracycline, and with proper therapy the mortality can be nil. So with proper treatment we can reduce the mortality rate up to 0%. And coming to the vector control, so mainly we have to clear the vegetation where the rats and mice are living, and the application of insecticides such as lindalin or chlorotin to the ground and the vegetation. So these are some control measures for vectors. Personal prophylaxis, here impregnating the clothes and blankets with mythical chemicals such as benzyl benzoate, and the application of mite repellents to the exposed skin repellents. So example for this mite repellents are diethyl toluamide. So if you are applying this mite repellents to the skin surface, we can protect ourselves from this scrub typhus. And if you see here, no vaccine exists at the present situation. And the next type that we are going to discuss is murine type, and these are the endemics which are flea borne typhus. So coming to the distribution of this disease, this murine typhus MT, it is a zoonosis, and it is worldwide in distribution, especially areas of high rat infestation, especially we can see in the areas of where there is high rat infestation, and it appears to be more prevalent in Southeast Asian and Western specific countries than previously recognized. So most of the cases can be seen in Southeast Asian and Western specific countries. So if you see in USA, the cases are tend to be scattered, and a successful isolation of the causative agent from the rats, fleas and bandicoots was made at many places in India. So if you see in India, they have made a successful isolation of these causative agents. And next one is focal infections are often associated with the docks and shipping places where rats are abundant. Mainly these focal infections are associated with mainly docks and the shipping places. So where the other types of goods which are coming from the other endemic areas. So there you can observe these focal infections. So coming to the agent factors here, so in the epidemiological determinants we'll see the agent factors. So the agent factor is Rickettsia typhi, that is Rickettsia mussuri. And coming to the reservoir of infection, the rats are the main reservoir of infection. So the main species of these rats are Rattus rattus and Rattus neurogaceus. And if you see the infection in rats, it is apparent, it is long lasting, and it is non fatal. So that's why the rats are the most dangerous reservoirs for this disease murine typhus. Coming to the mode of transmission here, the main mode of transmission is from rat to rat, and sometimes you can observe from rat to rat louse. So if you see the actual mode of transmission here, it is not transmitted by the rat bite of this rat flea, but it is mainly transmitted by the inoculation into the skin of feces of infected Yes, and you can sometimes it is also possibly by inhalation of these dried infective feces, or and if you see here in this murine type, there is no direct man-to-man transmission, and once infected, the flea remains infected for lifetime, and the flea cannot transmit the rickettsia transovarially. Coming to the incubation period here, incubation period is about 1 to 2 weeks. On an average, it will be about 12 days. Coming to the clinical features of this disease, the clinical features resemble that of a louse bronchitis, but these are milder and rarely fatal. And if you see the Wells-Felix reaction with the protease OX19, it becomes positive in the second week of the infection. Coming to the control measures here, mainly treatment we can have, the drug of choice is tetracycline, and this is the only drug of choice which is available. And if you see the rickettsial growth, it is mainly enhanced by the sulfonamides and the penicillin. So in case of the this rickettsial diseases, sulfonamides and penicillin, they has to be avoided, and these drugs should not be given, because whenever we are exposing these infection to the sulfonamides and penicillin injections, these are enhancing the presence, these are enhancing the growth of the rickettsial disease. The next thing you can do is control of the fleas. So residual insecticides, so these are effective against the fleas. Example is Maltheon. And if you see the next thing, rodent control. So these rodent control measure, they has to be implemented mainly in the affected areas. No murine typhus vaccine is currently available. The other type that we can discuss now is Indian tick typhus. Coming to this Indian tick typhus, if you see the epidemiological determinant, the agent factor is Rickettsia cornei. It is a member of spotted fever group of Rickettsia, and it is best known member, which is Rickettsial Rickettsiae, and the causative agent for Rocky Mountain spotted fever. Coming to the reservoir of infection here, mainly the tick is the reservoir of infection, and if you see, it is infective along all its life stages, and the average duration of this tick is about 18 months. And this rickettsia, it can be transmitted to dogs and various rodents and other animals, which assist in the maintaining of the disease cycle. So if you see the infection cycle here, so whenever an infected larvae is laying the eggs, these eggs are infected here. As I said, these ticks are getting infected for this lifetime. So during all their life cycles, these ticks remain infected. So you can see the infected stage in the larvae, you can see the infected stage in the nymph, you can see it in the adult form. From adult form, again, whenever it is laying eggs, you can observe the infected stage. So whenever an infected egg is laid down, the infected larvae are being born. These infected larvae are mainly depending upon the rodents such as rats. So whenever an uninfected larvae is present on the rodents, by this infected larvae, by this infected rodent, this larvae is also getting infected here. So these infected larvae is further developing into infected nymph. This infected nymph is capable of transferring into adult, as well as it is capable of transferring the disease to the rodents also. So this infected nymph here, it is growing into infected type of adults, male as well as female. So whenever these infected adults are going and infecting the dogs, as the dogs are pet animals for the humans, so whenever a healthy human is coming in contact with these animals, this man is resulting in the disease. Again, the adult larvae, whenever it is adult tick, whenever it is releasing the eggs, they are becoming infected. So this is the infection cycle in this Indian tick typhus. If you see here, from infected adult, infected eggs will come. From infected eggs, infected larvae will come. From infected larvae, it will grow into infected nymph. From nymph, again, it is becoming adult. From adult, it is going and affecting the cattle and pet dogs. So whenever a man is coming in contact with this pet dogs, he is becoming an accidental host. Again, the disease is being cycled in the same way. If you see here, the disease is not transferred to men by person to person. It is mainly transmitted to men through domestic means of transmission only, that is mainly from the ticks only. The ticks which are present on the pet animals are capable of infecting the human, not the person to person. So coming to the incubation period here, the incubation period is about 3 to 7 days. Coming to the clinical features here, if you see, mainly whenever you are examining the patient will give you an history of this recent tick bite. And whenever you are clinically examining the patient from head to toe assessment, you can find out a recent lesion that will reveal the site of the bite. You can observe the ischia there, and it is mainly occurring after an interval of 3 to 4 days. And if you see the symptoms here, you can observe acute onset of fever, and which is mainly persisting for 2 to 3 weeks. You can observe malaise and you can observe the headache. And if you see on the third day, a maculopapular rash is appearing, and it is very different. It is different from the other rickettsial rashes. So firstly, it appears on the extremities, mainly on the ankles and the wrist. So afterwards, it moves centripetally and involves all the rest of the body. So we have to clinically diagnose this along with the measles, because whenever, if you are not taking proper physical examination, you may confuse it with the atypical measles. That's what we have to check for the careful physiological examination. Coming to the control measures, so broad spectrum antibiotics are used here, and personal prophylaxis is the key for the control of this Indian tick typhus. So if any area is known to have this infected tick, so those areas must be avoided. Next thing is, you have to inspect your body daily. So if you find any kind of ticks, you have to remove those ticks so that the risk for this infection is reduced. And the third thing you can do is disinfect your dogs. So disinfecting your dogs, it will minimize the tick population. Next one is health education of the people in the mode of transmission by the ticks and the means of personal protection, that is equally important. So what you have to do, you have to health educate the people what are all the modes of the typhus transmission, so that whenever they are educated in a proper way, they will take all the control measures. So these are all the control measures that was followed in the tick typhus. With this, I would like to conclude the session here. In next session, we'll see regarding the Q fever, and we will conclude the rickettsial zoonosis. Thank you so much for watching. If you have any queries, you can contact me through my WhatsApp and email. If you like the content, please like, share and subscribe the channel. Thank you so much.